I'm actually from IBM, I will admit that. If you have any questions as we go along, please ask them. If you're wondering what I'm saying, somebody else is likely to wonder as well. If you want to discuss something, though, and you might feel argumentative at some point in this presentation, I suggest we leave that to the end. And we can continue over lunch. So I call this When Unix Meets the Mainframe Mindset. I should also say that Pipes is an IBM product, and I wrote it, actually. I suppose. So I'll start out by outlining what I think is the mainframe mindset. And then I'll speak of something called CMS, which stands for Conversational Monitor System, Cambridge Monitor System, Console Monitor System, or something like that. It's an IBM product. Then I'll do a couple of slides to show that I do understand what Unix Pipes is about. And then I'll speak about how CMS pipelines evolved from essentially the basic Unix model. The evolution was that I wanted to do computing paradigms that did not fit the Unix model. And I'll walk through how this evolved. The CMS pipeline is now entirely different from the Unix pipe. And finally, I'll do some summing up. Now, first of all, the mainframe mindset is an old mindset, right? Mainframes are old stuff. They're still around, and they're kicking ass. But if you want to describe it in one sentence, it would be multi-programmed and multi-user nowadays. And if it's multi-programmed and multi-user, then there are things that you do in Unix that you don't want to do. Like, you don't want to take an interrupt every 10 milliseconds if you're idle, right? Because that bothers some other user. It has a long tradition for efficiency, and the reason for that was that originally they weren't very fast. So you'd say, but they're fast now. But yes, they're fast, but there's still other users. So inefficiency is not tolerated, and it's punished because you get charged for what you do. So there's a very real motivator in the business world to be efficient here. And another thing, I mean, it has its tradition in punched cards. Probably few of you have ever seen a real punch card, but that's the reason for the 80-byte record. That was the punch card. And if I may put in a plug, the mainframes are reliable, robust, and usually well documented, unlike some things I've seen in the Unix world. Now, CMS, which is my time-sharing preference, if you haven't guessed it, was written in the mid to late 60s for the then recently announced System 360. It was part of the research project, so it was more like, let's build something to support ourselves. It was, and still is, a single-user system. So one user has a dedicated machine in which he runs CMS. He boots CMS, if you like. CMS has its ancestry in what was known, written at MIT in the early 60s, as the compatible time-sharing system. I'm sure none of you have ever heard of that before. But that's the mother of all time sharing systems. Now, even though you had your own machine, technology evolved or was desired to multi-program these users, and we did that by supplying each user a virtual machine, so he had the illusion of a standalone system. And CMS is now part of the IBM product ZVM. Now, here's a typical CMS installation. And I kid you not, CMS was designed to run on this kit. It was built on this kit. There's a CPU to the very left for you. That particular model there had all of 64 kilobytes. And that was a big one. Then there's a console printer keyboard, so that's your teletype of then, or IBM's equivalent of a teletype. It was a Selectric printing machine with a golf ball print head, so there was no carriage that moved out and hit you or anything. But I mean, this was a standard feature of 360 Model 30, which that is. We have the two disks here. There's a CMS systems disk on the left and the user disk, the 191, on the right. And each user, obviously the system would support only one user at a time. The user would arrive, plunk in his disk pack, and IPL the system, or if it wasn't already IPL'd, and then off he went, banging the printer keyboard. And there were editors, compilers. You know, what do you associate with interactive time-sharing use? Tapes as well. And this is the unit record equipment, as it was called then. And the lady is feeding cards into the card reader. Typically, I mean, before you got CMS, all programming on IBM kit was done by punching cards. You punched your program into the cards, had them compiled, got your output usually as a card deck, took it away with you, and ran it whenever you want. Anyhow, so that's the card. Sorry?
And don't drop it.
I beg your pardon?
And don't drop the file.
Ah, but they had serial numbers, so if you dropped them, you took them to a sorter and sorted them. And if they didn't have serial numbers, you were in deep shit, yes. And honestly, the answer, sir, is don't drop your cards. That's a card punch on the other side of that machine. And this is a printer. Now, this reader could read 1,000 cards a minute, and the printer could print 600 lines a minute. There were faster printers then. But this is your basic CMS configuration. Now, all of this can be virtualized so that you only have one bigger and more expensive box, but you then have a number of concurrent users. But each user has his own mainframe, and he can IPL CMS if he wants to do interactive work. He could IPL OS 360 if he wanted to do that, or he could IPL CP, as the control program was called, if he wanted to test the basic control program. So the control program ran under itself. So no night shifts. Everything done in prime time. Now, the bad news is that CMS and the tradition of all of these systems was that you had dedicated software for each piece of I/O, and you did not have a unified standard in, standard out model. So that means that if you wanted to access devices natively in CMS, you would write assembler programs and you would use macros that would then, you would use different macros for different devices. Let me put it that way. This was how it worked until I did CMS pipelines. Then we had a standard I/O interface. Shell languages, CMS works different than Unix. In Unix, you have the initial program that's usually the shell. And that would then read your output, interpret it, and you could even program in the Unix shell. The CMS is sort of a two-level, so you have a command prompt, if you like, and you can issue commands. And these commands can then be what's called execs, or rex programs, which would then be interpreted. So you would typically edit the file, your command script, and then execute it. So we could call it a shell, but it's a different kind of shell. But the point is that those kind of languages are interpreted and not suitable for data manipulation. But they're good at sorting out logic, for instance. So, you know, I have this kind of record, what should I do with it? But then doing it is not, it's possible, but it's not cheap and it's not easy. But the combination of procedural code and pipelines, which is essentially functional programming, because you're not concerned with the actual workings of a program that reads the record or anything. In a pipeline, you select the function you want to be performed, a transformation, if you like, right? I mean, that's the way the Unix pipe works. Now, the combination of the two means that you can write what logic you need to write in an easily debugged and programmed language. And when you then want to churn some data, you hand that over to the pipeline, and the pipeline does that very efficiently. Now, the Unix pipe is essentially, the way I see it, a series of programs, and you can pass data from the output of one to the input of the next. I mean, from standard out to standard in. It is linear. So you have essentially standard in on the very left and standard out on the very, very right here, right? I mean, the point is that they are built on top of these three system calls. So the shell itself has not got a lot of programming to make a pipe. A rich, initially, it would simply fire off the programs as it scanned them down the command and forget all about them. And when it got to the last program in the pipeline, it would exec that program rather than fork it. And that's the reason why the return code from the pipe is the return code from the last command. The dispatching of the individual programs in the pipeline is unpredictable. I mean, you can observe what it is, but I don't think you can predict it in general. I mean, it's reproducible, but not predictable, let me put it that way. And the return value, as I said, was from the last program. And if any of the other programs would fail, you wouldn't get to know. Now, this is where the mainframe mindset says, no way. No way do we work that way. We don't do that here. Now, some of you may know that Bash 3, version 3, introduced the zo-pipefail. If you haven't done so already, make sure all your shell scripts start out that way, or you set that in your profile or your RC file or something. You definitely want to know if something goes wrong. But it's interesting, that's the only change to Unix pipes ever since edition 2 of Unix, which hit the streets in 1972 or thereabouts. Now, CMS and I'll just say CMS pipelines here is a set of interconnected programs, but not with a linear topology. Not necessarily, I should say, with a linear topology. In general, you would have a multi-streamed program. That's That's very common. The dispatching is not preemptive. It's coroutines, and it is predictable, and you can reason about it. And you'll see later why this is important. Another difference between Unix is that the movement of a record from one stage to the next is unbuffered. So whereas in the Unix pipe, you go through the buffer cache, and essentially when you fill up whatever is allocated to the pipe, you switch dispatching. This is not the way it works here. Also, because it's not integrated with the CMS shell, it is simply a CMS command, and pipe seemed to be the obvious one to choose. So it could have had any name, obviously. It's just a command. Now, I mentioned that the basic interface to the hardware was rather device dependent. So instead of the Unix I/O model, I adopt the model where I have device driver programs to access what you would call I/O redirection. But hey, I run a program that figures out how to twiddle a disk file rather than do I/O redirect. But it looks the same, except that there is a vertical bar, right? Because the greater than is not redirect, it is in fact a program that's called greater than. There are many host command environments in CP and CMS where you can issue a command, get a response. And the pipeline idiom is that you read your command from the input, issue it, and produce the response on your output. So that's pretty straightforward. Filters are programs, I mean, also in the Unix terminology, are programs that somehow massage the data passing through them, but don't interface to anything else. And the tradition is that they should be well-defined, small, efficient. And I certainly subscribe to that tradition as well. The mainframe mindset does not preclude being simple. let me stress that. All right. Selection stages are programs that will select records based on some criterion. I mean, essentially what in Unix would be called grep. Right? Grep will select some records and discard others. And then there's a slew of other things that don't fall into this model. They're gateways, space warps. TCP/IP is integrated in all this, and you can do wonderful things. Now, the basic model about what is a program in CMS pipelines. I mean, it is a program, and the program has a number of input streams and a number of output streams. It's entirely up to the program how it reads and writes those streams, but it's up to whoever writes a pipeline to decide how they're interconnected. And there is a syntax for that to express it as a linear command, but I won't show it to you. The dispatcher essentially starts up the program. When the program writes output, the dispatcher regains control, dispatches something else to have this record consumed, and so on. There is much more dispatcher activity than there would be in a similar Unix pipe. On the other hand, the path lengths, I mean, the full round trip from you put something into the, you write a record until it comes out on the other side of the pipe is about 150 instructions. So we're pretty efficient here. So dispatcher starts the stage, calls it like, I mean, you have to call it at its entry point clearly, so that's what we do. Now, what can a stage do then? It can peak at a record. Now, peak means that it gets to see the record, wherever it is, but it stays there. So this is what OS people would call locate mode I/O processing. I call it peak. I think that's easier to understand. So you peak at a record. Now you can see it. Then you can decide what to do with it, how to transform it, where to send it. And then you produce an output record. So you write. And after you have written the derivative work, if you like, you then consume the input record. At that point, the input record is released and you're not supposed to look at it anymore because it'll be gone. I mean, programs can do whatever they like. I mean, there's no way one can enforce that, of course, but you won't have a lot of sympathy if you break the rules of this game. To support the multi-stream model, you need a way to select which stream to read or write. So the peak and writing and consuming are related to the currently selected stream. And obviously peak works on an input stream and write works on an output stream, so that's implied. You can also wait for a record to arrive on any of your input streams. So this allows you to respond to whatever. And your program could have the convention that the primary input stream it triggers this action, the secondary input stream triggers another action, or whatnot. It's entirely up to the programmer. Finally, you can sever a stream. And when you sever a stream, it means that you do not wish either to produce more output on it or to consume more input from it. So once you've severed a stream, end of file will then sort of travel out that way. How far it propagates depends on the programs in general. Now, if you follow the protocol to peak, produce, and consume in a loop in your program, then your program will not, as it's called, delay the record. And this is an important concept, and it'll be clear very soon. So that was the initial implementation. Much like the Unix one, straight single pipeline, standard I/O, device drivers, but it's just plain old programs. I did do the aggregated return value. That means that the return value from the pipe command is sort of the worst return value from any of the stages, rather than some random number. And it all fitted within the 8K CMS transient area initially, because that was the only place it could run. It's somewhat larger now. Right. So the first extension was that I...
I'm not so sensitive. You have a master file, an old master, you apply transactions to it, and you get a new master. And I should probably have used tubulars rather than disks there. Because you had your master tube, your transactions in cards, your report in a listing, and the new master on another tube, right? Now, we can do that in Unix, but I wanted to do it generalized, because what I was really after was something called modular update. And that is that the CMS tradition is the opposite of the Unix tradition. In Unix, you would keep the most current version of the file as the file for a program, for instance. And you then have diffs that could take you back to the various incarnations of the program. In CMS, you start with the base version of the program and then you put updates on top. So you apply all updates when you compile a program. Try after compiling it. This has a lot of advantages from the CMS mindset. I mean, I'm not knocking units on this one, but what I wanted to do was, first of all, to apply multi-level update without using intermediary files, right? So because this update, this update and this update are performed in parallel. So it's really driven by this file. Right? I mean, this file has to be there sequentially, and this one will be in the sequence of whatever records needs to be updated, and the update is driven by the sequence numbers we had before. Right? So this program will read the file and merge the update against it and then produce the updated run, just like you do on Unix. This one would then do the same thing, and this one would do the same thing. So essentially, you have one record from each of those four files in storage at the same time. You don't buffer the entire file. However, you want the transaction log for the first program, for the first update, to be in front of the second one and the third one. You don't want those interspersed. I mean, you'd go crazy if you did that. So here's one of my gateways. It's called Fanin. Those who have done electronics engineering probably know what Fanin is really. But it seemed a good metaphor here. So Fanin, you copy the primary input to its output, then the secondary input to its output, and then the tertiary input to its output. And that means that you have to buffer each of these. So you buffer the update logs in the hope that they're smaller than the master file. And then it becomes very efficient. Now, that was the motivation for merger stream pipelines. And yeah, that's sort of modern technology, though, isn't it? Now, it turned out, in the development of this, it turned out that I had my focus on something initially, and I did something to the pipeline, like introduce multi-stream pipes. And then we discovered that it was really for something else that particular feature was essential. I mean, multi-level update is nice, but multi-stream pipes is essential. Now, what happens here? The local stage will select records from some criterion. The ones that it selects go on the primary stream, and they go to this guy, who is a fan-in from any stream, so that's Fanny Nanny. and it'll just read records as they arrive and then copy them to the output. Now, those that are discarded by Locate are not thrown away. They're just, by convention, passed on to the secondary output. And then we can do with them whatever we want. And so far, you could easily write a shell in Unix that would support the same paradigm. Where you can't compete is here that we select some records, we do some change only to those records, and we then merge them back into the original sequence of the file. Ooh, how did you do that? So this is where the not delaying the record comes in. Now, Locate peeks at gets an input record, yeah? It's in a buffer somewhere out here. He then makes up his mind and writes it. If the record travels this way, this guy will also peek at the record. No, it'll select any stream, then peek at whatever it gets, and then copy it out. Right? At the point when this guy writes Here's out to the record, nothing within this pipeline segment can move. They're blocked. This guy's blocked because this guy has not consumed the input record, and this guy's blocked because whoever's out here has not consumed the input record yet. So that's why not delaying the record is an important concept and something that pipelines programmers need to think very carefully about. So you put a short in here instead of change. Short would have necessity read all its input before it produced output, and you'd get a different order of records. Possibly not the one you wanted. Possibly the one you wanted, who knows? So, but the point is, the selection stages soon got support for the secondary output stream. And that essentially made it possible to do if-then-else kind of logic. This paradigm, we can also chop a record up into three segments and then pass only one of the segments to a particular stage and then join them back together again as one record. So that means that this paradigm also allows me to apply a transformation or anything to a subset of a record. Unix won't be able to do that ever either. The term for a cascade of locate or selection stages is a decoding network, because the electronic term is a decoder. Now, having done the multi-stream pipelines, it started to become embarrassing that you would write a pipeline and then one of the stages would issue an error message and you would have crashed your output file or done something else you didn't want to do. So I then implemented syntax check. And if you look at it at a program in the pipeline as an object, it would then be an object that has two methods, a syntax check method and a main run method. Now, the rule of the game was that the syntax check method must not do anything irreversible. So it's sort of a voting mechanism. It's essentially a two-phase commit, right? Everybody does their syntax check, they say, yeah! And then we can go, right? And if anyone fails, we stop it over. Now, the point here is that if we have syntax check, and if... That's a greater than, right? If greater than doesn't start because something else had a syntax error, then it can't crash a file because it never gets to run, so it never has a chance. Now, to implement this object kind of nature, I made what was called a program descriptor. And that then has information about that the program, what is a support, for instance. Must it be first? Must it not be first? Or can it be anywhere in a pipeline? Now, putting a stage that would read a file downstream in a pipeline doesn't seem to be a useful thing to do. You also see up front how many streams it would support, and if it were connected, if there's more than the supported number of streams, then this would be rejected out of hand at the syntax check. Also say whether it supports arguments, must have them or must not have them. And then the method to perform the syntax check and then the main function. So that was the syntax check. Something that Unix also can do, actually, is essentially a subroutine pipeline. That's if you, from one program that is in a pipeline, invoke another pipeline, that's a subroutine pipeline, isn't it? So, here comes the interesting point. Then the fire can travel into the Shepparton pipeline. So if there's no more data, then news guys will see no more data. That's understandable. I think everybody would want it that way. But in the fire cannot travel out of the Shepparton pipeline. So if this, of course it can't. Now, if this guy terminates, for whatever reason, then Ender Fire will travel this way as you would probably expect. But it will also travel this way. So this one will see Ender Fire on its output. It's Ender Fire just the same, but it's input output. And this guy will then also see Ender Fire, and then all of the pipeline, the subroutine pipeline, will have terminated. At that point, at the point when those guys terminate, the original connections are re-established. And so if there's more input, this program can then peek at it and decide what to do. The subroutine pipeline you insert can be manufactured to the particular data at hand. So you peek at a record, say this is case A, B, C, D. For case A, I run this subroutine. For case B, I run this subroutine. For case C, I run this subroutine. And Unix can't quite do that because any read on Unix is a consuming read. So the difference here is that the record that he, the B space, decides on to issue this subroutine is still available here. And the subroutine will also see that record. Now, if the subroutine doesn't want to see the record, it can throw it away. I mean, that's acceptable. So that was a subroutine pipeline. That's one. Then something emerged that we call the sipping pipeline because it sips at the input. And that essentially, it's like a subroutine pipeline, but it explores the ability to propagate in the file backwards. So when a record arrives that begins with XYZ, two labels will terminate. So that causes these two guys to terminate, and then the entire subroutine is terminated and the streams are reconnected. And we have record XYZ still here. It's very important. Then it reconnects. So that has essentially performed some operation on the input stream up to the occurrence of the next record that starts with a particular string. So if you have units that need to be processed and can be processed efficiently with the subroutine pipeline, then you can do those in a loop so that your loop is not on every record but on every group of records. And the idea is that the subroutine pipeline will run what's called bare metal stages. That's real assembler programs. There's no interpreted code involved in the subroutine. And that's very efficient it comes in. There's something called dynamic reconfiguration, which is a variation on this. That was made to support nested include. So we have A and B. B decides that it needs to divert from the current input stream to another input stream. And it then says, I want to read included file and pass it to my primary input as it is. And what happens then is that, just like with the subroutine pipeline, this connection is temporarily broken and the new pipeline is inserted. Now the difference is that when this added pipeline comes to end the file, the Ender file is presented to this program. So it sees Ender file, and then it says, get rid of my current input stream. And that restores this connection. And that's how you can... The reason for this is that you might want to do something at the end of each subfile that you've just included. Maybe you want just to add comments to the aggregate output, but you certainly need to know end of file as well as beginning of file for each of these subfiles you've included. Now, setting out a pipeline, but because the CMS pipelines has a dispatcher, it also has a scanner parser to pass the command. This is done in several passes over the input command. First of all, you determine the overall structure of it so that you can allocate whatever descriptors you need to keep track of all this. And then you resolve the programs. They have to be resolved somehow. I'll mention that in a second. First, it looks for built-in programs. They're sort of, if you like, shell built-in commands. Then it looks in attached filter packages, so you can package up your programs and have them to work like built-in filters, but they could be supplied by somebody else. So users could add their own very fast interface this way. If it isn't resolved from there, then it'll look for shared scripts. The way it figures out what it actually is that it looks at the resolved entry point. Now, if that is an executable instruction, then it's an old-fashioned simple program with the original interface. And if it's anything else, then there's essentially a magic number that says this is a program descriptor, and then who knows how to deal with that. So the starting of a pipeline goes through several decision points. First, it says, is the overall structure okay? I mean, if there's something broken in the input command, then we give up here. If we then scan and can we resolve the stages, do they have the correct attributes and so on and so on. Then we do the syntax check. And first, at that point, do we start the programs. So it's not until we've been through all the other checks that programs are allowed to do anything that does damage to anything. Or allocate resources, or whatever. Now, but even though we're now running the program, so to speak, there's still... This is sort of the latest in the commit levels. The problem I'm trying to solve here is that some programs need to allocate resources. They can't do that in the syntax check because the syntax check, they'll have no chance to deallocate those resources if any syntax check fails. So I wanted to be able to allocate in a controlled fashion resources so that I could prevent sort of the main pipeline from running. Then I'm seeing a larger and larger and larger class of errors. So, but the commit level itself is just a 32-bit integer. A stage is at some particular commit level. The program descriptor will say which commit level the stage will start at. The old plain old programs have a default, 0. Rex programs start on commit level -1. There's some rules. Now, when the pipeline starts running, it starts at the lowest commit level. at earlier stages in the pipeline. And only those stages have just passed. They can then do whatever they want at that point. When the stage has done whatever it needs to do at that particular commit level, it commits to a higher level. Typically, it would go from where it started to zero, but it could take many steps, intermediary steps. Now, at the time the dispatcher then would dispatch this program again, everything else would also have moved up to the same commit level. The return value from the commit function is the aggregate return code at that point. So if anything else has failed, the program gets to know. And it can then deallocate the resources and terminate itself. If once the dispatcher has seen a program return with a non-zero return code, it will not start further programs. It will simply run whatever is still there, supply the return value on the commit, and expect the programs to unwind and terminate. In general, data will not be able to flow. And this is exactly the way I want it. I mean, it's not something that just fell out of some coincidence. This is how I want it. Now, stages can allocate resources. They can have a protocol that says I want to allocate resource A on commit level -10, resource B on commit level -9, and so on. And this is the usual way to avoid deadlocks in resource allocation. And the stage can determine that the pipeline will be abandoned and take appropriate action. And, as I said, by convention, but it's entirely a convention, data moves on level zero. If you have two programs next to each other on commit level -10, they can pass a record between them if they like. But they better be sure that they both are at that commit level. There are some interactions with subroutine pipelines and all that, which I won't go into here. And REX programs being interpreted have an interface, so in this interface, can know whether the program has done a commit or not, and then if it does IO, it can perform an implied commit so that REX programmers don't need to worry about this unless they want to exploit it. As an example, a safe file replacement method. The greater than program checks, first of all, the file name syntax in the syntax check routine. Then it starts on commit level 0, and it produces a temporary file. Then it commits to run, and by convention, all data has stopped moving when we get to commit level 1. It can now inspect what is the return code from the pipe command, essentially, and it can verify that data was, in fact, transported correctly, or at least nothing failed in the transport phase. If it doesn't get return code 0 at that point, it can remove the temporary file and leave the existing file alone. And then, finally, if everything went okay, it can then trash the old file by renaming the temporary file. So this avoids the embarrassment of trashing the file because you have something that went wrong after the syntax check. So, in retrospect, I think it took about 15 years to write all of this. I have have a picture here of the entire development team, but we haven't got old enough technology to show it, so I'll pass it around. It evolved to support many data processing pipelines that ran in the Unix pipe. The enhancement of the generalized don't bother. Just come along. Sure. Because I'm almost done. Generalized enhancement turned always out to have some unexpected side effects. For example, in multi-stream pipes, you've got decoding networks. I think you've got everybody's attention there. No, hang on, wait a sec. Dynamic reconfiguration enabled functional programming. And syntax check gave us a program descriptor. And that had a lot of use, I mean, from, if you like, a theoretical point of view. Right, that's it. Any questions, comments, discussion, shouting, protests? Okay.
So
how do I help the user debug his pipeline, right? I issue meaningful and identified messages, for instance. No, but I mean, I issue a message and identify the exact point in the command string where the pass fails, for instance. There are options to get additional information. You can insert stages in the pipeline that display the data going through so that you can find out why a record didn't go the way you wanted it to. That kind of stuff. I mean, nobody seems to know about, I mean, if people know, it's about the amount of diagnostics they did, not the lack of them. Yes? The question is, the syntax checking. It's really on two levels. There's an overall gross syntax check. Is there an argument string where there shouldn't be one? For instance, that would be handled by the scanner. Then there's the syntax method of the program itself. And that get invoked. And if that returns non-zero, then the syntax has failed for that stage. It's then up to the program itself to issue meaningful messages.
So, every program in the system has to provide such a method?
In one way or another, yes. I mean, if anything related to the contents of the parameters to a stage can only be checked by that stage. Right. Okay. It does. The question was, does the commit level replace the syntax check? And you're quite right, it does. And if I'd done the commit levels first, I wouldn't have done the syntax check. I mean, it would have been up to the program to perform the syntax check, but it would then do it at a low commit level. Now, if you like, you can consider the syntax check routine to be commit level minus infinity. I mean, that's essentially the way I handled it. Yes?
dass die Tochter nach dem Business in der Lage getastet wird, in der Hilfe einzuhalten, die hat dieses Schirm in der Frage. The question is, a speak of efficiency, and why do I switch tasks for each record? Is that correct? Well, it has to do that because I want to maintain record semantics, so it has to be that way, so I just have to make it efficient, right?
You probably have to make this argument
over to me. Oh, all right. The co-routine paradigm was one that evolved in the 60s, before you had generalized multiprogramming. You have multiprogramming in that you have separate units of execution, each with their state, like stack, if you like. But they only switch tasks by giving up control voluntarily.
It's not like the system, it's
processing. Do you have?
The billing system doesn't have this.
That's just a preemptive dispatcher, not a co-routine dispatcher, I guess. And also, this is all this in your machine, so it all runs in one outer space.
Okay.
I wouldn't be able to do it in 150 instructions if I had to switch out of space. Also, as there is no real task switch at the multitasking level, the chances of cache pollution are smaller, and that helps. It certainly helps a lot. But let me give you an example from real life. I mean, somewhere we were, while we were doing this pipeline thing back in the early 90s, there was a guy at the account who had written a PL1 program to look for things in a file. Yeah? Essentially locate. And he was very proud of this program because it ran very fast. It only ran 4 times slower than the equivalent pipeline. Now, he had algorithmic clutter, so I told him what algorithm to use, and then he could get his handcrafted PL1 program to run at twice the speed of the pipeline. So that's your overhead, if you like. And the alternative is to write a huge PL1 program, right? Nobody wants to do that. Nobody ever wanted to do that. No, except from those who earn their salary by doing that, and they are paid by the word, so to speak. Yes? No questions?
So when did we get it in Unix?
When do you get it in Unix? When is Unix ready? I've been asked this question before. And I have dabbled a bit in Unix in the meanwhile. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Linux 390, but there is a Unix implementation that runs in a virtual machine side by side with CMS now. And that means that it runs on the same hardware, and therefore the programs would, in theory, be transportable. There is only one challenge here, and that is that The Linux system runs in ASCII. You're familiar with ASCII, I'm sure. Now, if I tell you that CMS runs EPCBIC, you probably don't know what I mean. EPCBIC is quite like ASCII. It's only that blank is hex 30 rather than hex 20, right? So it's twice as good, isn't it? But that is a challenge. The other thing I didn't tell you was that the whole thing is written in assembly. Stacks are pre-allocated. I mean, this is...
If you have a single address space, you can't have in unbounded stacks. Now, the way these programs are written, I can compute the required stack space and allocate that initially. So that's the dynamic size required by any of the building programs. This can be determined at compile time. And to make that happen on Unix, that could happen. I seriously looked into it in two ways. Now, this Linux 390 is just simply taking the code, somehow fixing the ASCII issue, which is non-trivial, and then write something around the CMS pipeline. CMS pipelines is also built like an operating system, right? So it has interfaces, and most of it is written completely independent of the system. That's why it runs in CMS as well as in VS, or ZOS. Because it relies on the object code being the same format and executed at those places. So to make the pipeline run on Linux 390, I'd need to produce an ELF format object that would also solve the ASCII issue. And then I would need to put something around it that would query the library routines if your system queries. I also look at taking the 370 machine code and converting it to IS6000 machine code, because that would also be a way of pulling off that same stunt. And IBM kept changing the IS6000 architecture underneath all the time, so I gave that up. But actually, a lot of people in IBM looked seriously at converting machine code to IS6000, I think. But nothing came of it. Now, the good thing about the Linux 390 and the IS6000 is that they're big engine machines. That is, they are opposite to the Intel thing. Right? So the lowest addressed byte of an integer is the most significant one. Depends who asked me. When I wanted it announced, I wanted it to be too far again to announce. So I counted lines of code in a very strange fashion, and I came up with a very small number. Not quite a one-liner, no. But I don't know. 200,000? And now you want to ask me what programming language is written in this? Well, it doesn't really matter. And you're right, I could do it 1-2. That's pretty good going. Others, you're not so efficient. Saying 390 or 372 assembler is a misnomer. This assembler is what's known as a macro assembler. And the programming language I use is more like Pascal. It has nested procedures, it can allocate work areas, and I can write generalized instructions that would react to the format of input data and things like that. So there's very little machine code in it. But it's correct that it's compiled by the assembler. Is it?